Amen. For the final time in this series, we're going to Ephesians chapter 6, and I want to read beginning at verse 10. The whole armor of God. Paul lays it out, and I think no doubt he had in mind the way a Roman soldier looked as far as looking at the parts of the armor. He knew what parts were a Roman soldier wore. They were warriors and fighters. And these are the pieces as he goes through six of them and lays them out in this text. So let me read beginning at verse 10 down through the text, and then we'll land at verse 18 for today's message. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of His might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the wicked one or the evil one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints. And also for me, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. And may the Lord add His blessing to reading and hearing of that text. We've come to the last statement, basically. With respect to what we as God's people are to do, instructed to take on the armor, and then at the end of that, at verse 18, here's what he says. We take the helmet of salvation, we take the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, and then verse 18 begins after a comma, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. And then to that end, to keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication again, prayer, for all the saints and also for me. And then he instructs what he wants the prayer for him to basically consist of. Our life is lived at times in conflict, and we sometimes are not paying attention and recognizing that. There's spiritual warfare going on in our world all the time. And we find ourselves in conflict, and I think sometimes we fail to see it because we just kind of sign it off as our nature, our way. You know, every once in a while I just blow it. Or you might just every once in a while be picked off with a fiery dart that gives some attitude thing something, and then you have to deal with it. I have done that more than once. Anybody else? Now, my fiery darts are always sweet. I don't ask for anything. Oh, Grace is talking to me again. The fiery darts belong to the devil. We are the ones that have the shield of faith that quenches all of them. Remember that? All of them. So the possibility of being armed as you live your life to the point that you will not give in to those placement shots or those kinds of things is significant. If we have a shield that will quench all of them, then the possibility of having that in place and keeping it there as we live Now remember, this is metaphor. We're not talking about a shield in your great big shield that you stand behind all the time and carry it around made out of wood, leather, iron, whatever. We're not talking about, we're talking about spiritual armor. We're talking about the armor that has been provided for us through the work of Jesus Christ. We're talking about the armor provided that encompasses the whole of our lives, that makes it potential for us to live as Christians in a world that's unchristian and bear witness to the gospel without being overwhelmed. Ooh, it's quiet. But I think that's true. Sometimes we think we're going to get overwhelmed. But in this matter of conflict and struggle against the devil, we recognize there are principalities and powers, and there are rulers of the darkness of this world and spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places, all listed in the text. A lot of warfare. A lot of operations of the enemy on our part. Our Lord, when he was here in the flesh, was in that warfare. Jesus, walking here on the earth, encountered the devil, principalities and powers, spiritual wickedness in heavenly places. He walked right in through it. He was attacked, opposed. All kinds of things happened to him. In fact, he was tempted as a man in all points like we are, which is what the scripture tells us. And the first thing we know about Jesus after he is baptized in the Jordan and the Holy Spirit comes like a dove and lands upon him is that he is led by that same Spirit right into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. Got to get these temptations started right up front here. You're going to be dealing with this all the time. It happened right in the Garden of Gethsemane when he was praying, committing himself, trying to surrender to what was his plan. And it sounded so easy at times for him, I know, when his guys were following and listening and he was marching toward Jerusalem with that hard, strong commitment to do what the Father wanted from him. It was beautiful until he got there and ended up with all the stuff that went on in that Passion Week, and then he's there in the garden praying to surrender to the will of the Father perfectly, and he finds himself weeping and finds himself sweating blood right through his pores. The stress of that had to be severe. Why? Because he's going to take our place. He's going to stand before a holy God and say, I take their place, and knows us. And he went to the place of the death and suffered separation. Here's the chaos in his heart. When God the Father, for a moment at least, could not acknowledge him for who he was, turned from him. He was a sacrifice to satisfy the wrath of God against sin. Now, don't get too upset about saying God had wrath, because wrath is pretty consistent in God. Our wrath is the explosive kind. Wrath was a steady attitude toward sin. He will never accept it as a part of glory's existence. He's going to deal with it. The wrath of God is solid. He hates sin. Isn't that true? And he sent his Son to deal with sin in us. In order that he might accept us in his beloved Son as justified, as acceptable child of God, his. In and through the blood and the resurrection of Jesus. When I say blood, you could say death. Because it was that death, poured out blood. That's what we see on the table when we have communion. We see a body broken apart. We see blood having flown out. Death. God's plan. So in the flesh, he knows what suffering is. He knows what the enemy is. He knows what a battle is. And we, because We are Christians. And somehow we have to recapture significance for that word, Christian. That's too much of it. It doesn't exactly mean biblical Christian when you start talking to people in our world. And just because you're born in America doesn't make you a Christian. And there have been people through the years who thought that. If you take the biblical Christian, we're talking about, I guess you could just carry it out, little Christ. But we know that doesn't mean that we're going to be just like in every way Jesus and can do what he did and all that, because we're not Jesus. But we are in Christ and Christ is in us, and we live that position, that place. The beauty of that, the wonder of that. So as Christians in Christ, what do you expect? The enemy of God coming against you at times? Not because you're such a big deal or I'm such a big deal, but because he is a big deal. And the devil is trying his best all the time to come against that God in heaven who is our Father and our Lord. So as Christians, we are inevitably involved in this fight and conflict. And nothing will be more deadening to us than to start the Christian life with the notion that you are finished with trials and trouble. We sometimes hinder people with our simple way of looking at it. We say, look, just give your life to Jesus, you won't have any more trouble. Hey, I'm glad nobody preached that to me when I first got into church and heard the gospel preached as a kid. But I heard it preached a lot, and you want to do it sometime to encourage people, but it's not the truth. In fact, it is very likely that once you surrender to Christ, you're going to have some tests and some challenges and some situations that are necessary, because you got to be tested yourself. You got to stand. Sometimes we're tempted when the devil comes to try to get us to do what is wrong. Sometimes we're tested when the Father comes to knowing, hey, I know how they're going to do this because I know them, so let's put them through it. Does he always know the outcome? Yeah, if you're going to believe he knows everything, he's going to know the outcome. That's what I love about the Job story. Job never got to think about it. It just was a test. And it was huge. Here's what I concluded studying Job so far. Job's friends and he had the same theology. Are you still here? Same theology. I mean, his three friends that came looking to see what in the world he had done to get him in such trouble all had the same theology as Job had before he got in trouble that he couldn't explain. And they would say, Job, you did something wrong, buddy. They were a great help. You sinned. You know our theology. You sinned, or God would not have done this to you. And yet when you go back to see what Job was like, you want to pick out a guy that's righteous in the setting of the day. A righteous worshiper of God he was. He didn't know everything right, but he certainly had committed himself to worship that God and his family. When you read the opening of that story, Job did not change anything he had done. He did not do anything that could be classified in his conscience or anywhere else as opposing God and worthy of judgment. In the right end scenario, all his friends having the same situation would have said the same thing. They're all from the same place. They've got this idea. Here's what they believe theologically in the simplest form I have it. If God blesses and prospers you and you do great, you are accepted by him. God bless you, you're doing great. And that's what Job had been doing all along. That's what his friends had been doing all along. The second thing is, if something bad happens and you lose stuff and you lose family, and he lost everything, you have done awful stuff. God is dealing with you for it. God's mad at you. You've sinned against him, and he's going to take you out of there. No. But if you go into life like some of us do when we come to Christ, believing that you're never going to have another problem or challenge or battle. Change that. Begin to read the scriptures again and understand that there are not too many well-known names in the Bible who didn't face some stuff. Not too many Christians that didn't go through hard things. We love to escape everything, but I look at a bunch of faces here I've got acquainted with over the years. There's a lot of folk in this room who sat in hard places. Beat up by stuff, but not defeated. Still living, still walking, still praising God. Feeling the pain of every loss, the struggle of every war they faced. And God has not failed you. He just keeps changing you. And just because we've been through places doesn't mean He's through putting us through places either. Because this is the journey, saints. He's getting us ready for glory. He's getting us ready for an inheritance undefiled and waiting for us in that glorious place. We got so many folks sitting up there now, we just got to get ready to go and look forward to it all the time. It's a good thing. Death is the last enemy. I want to stick with that. We're going to talk about death. We'll talk about death as an enemy from now to the end. But even then, God takes that enemy and says, you're defeated by the cross. He overcame death, hell, and the grave. He said, you're done. This, my child, is walking through this death thing of yours like a door right into my presence. You lose. I win. So if you want to think about being on a winner's side, just stick with Jesus. You can't lose there. But He will work some things in your life. And some of the things that He encounters us with, and I can testify with many of you, are not the pleasant things we wanted to happen. They're not the joy bell days. They're hard days. But He brings us through. Because we are Christians, we must expect to go through some places that are testing and hard. Now, that's kind of the intro. What is the meaning of this statement by Paul in verse 18? Listen, what is the meaning of this? Praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. Now, you know what praying is. Well, I know what praying is. Praying, we're going to talk to God about some things. We're going to take our requests to Him. That's supplications. But we're going to pray all kinds of prayers. Some of the most effective prayers are those where we don't talk so much. For me. Because if I'm talking, it's hard for me to hear. And God is able to speak to us, whisper to us, clarify His word to us, all kinds of things. So here we put on the whole armor and we stand in our place where God has us. And you've got the Word of God, which is the sword of the Spirit. The Word of God. I love the image of Jesus, chapter 1 of Revelation, and later in Revelation, where He has a sword coming out of His mouth. The Word spoken, the Word of flame, the Word active, alive. So we got the Word of God, this sword, which wasn't a big sword, but a little sharp knife. Most theologians reading that will tell you the word this is translated here from the Greek does not reference a sword. It references a sharp knife like maybe a butcher would use, a priest butchering. Got to get sacrifices ready. Or maybe a scalpel, sharp like that. We can just take it and do what the writer to the Hebrews said, sharper than a two-edged sword, dividing asunder joints and marrow, right on down to the intent and the intentions of the heart. When this blade goes in, this spiritual blade goes into our lives as we are dealt with by the Lord, it opens us up from the outside in, and God deals with us from the inside out in our place. So we realize it doesn't make sense to run from the knife, because the knife is there to heal. The word is there to heal. It's like a sharp, like a, are like a. It's not a thing like we're talking about. It's just like that. It's a metaphor. I don't know how it works, how we use it. And so he says here that we are to pray, and we are to pray at all times, always. And we are to pray with all prayer, at all times with all prayer, all kinds of prayer. How many have found that there are times in the burden of your life when the only prayer that you were able to utter was a groan or a cry of loss or pain? Are they real prayers? Do you think there are prayers that can be prayed as you walk down the sidewalk, or prayers that you pray while you drive? You better pray while you drive the car. Stay alert. Stay alert. Remember the next part of this down here said, be alert. Persevere. Yeah. Prayer is something that goes toward God from the heart. And much of our praying is done with few words, or maybe none. At all times, with all prayer, in the Spirit. Now, that's the one line that gets defined and talked about and wrestled with and carried about for a long ways. And I'll talk about that in a minute. Paul, seeing the Roman soldiers, saw the pieces of the armor, and he just lays them out here for us. And then when they're all in place, he said, listen, the war has been won. The battle is ongoing because the enemy is still at work here. And you got to walk here and live here, and you got to know the word in order to speak the word, and you have to trust in the Lord, you know, has conquered and given you the victory, and you have to just realize these things as you walk and pray. But my job, your job, first of all, praying all the time, at all times or always, depending on the translation you're reading. Praying is something we have to do, and we have to keep on doing it in connection with that whole armor of God. We have a conflict with the flesh and the devil. We could say world with that, but that makes up kind of what's in the world, the flesh and the devil. We have a conflict with that all the time as we live for Jesus. So we put this armor on, and then we pray always with all prayer in the Spirit in every circumstance, and we keep on praying. How long? Well, that's his business and yours. How long do I pray for certain things? Long as certain things need prayer. Or until he gives me a freedom to stop. Let me read something to you. A little bit of it's on, you, how many have read the lines on the front of the bulletin? You read them yet? Okay. They're not short reading, but they're not long reading. A few stanzas of a hymn that in its original writing was titled by Charles Wesley, The Whole Armor of God. That's what he titled. It's not titled that anymore. It's called Soldiers of Christ Rise, the first line in the poetry. I want to read, it talks about that armor all the way down, all these verses. Here's the lines I ran into in something I was reading, just four lines. And you can find songs real easy on the internet. Did you know that? Just type in one word and you got it. Usually. Wonderful. They give you all kinds of historical help. And I have no way of checking to see if they're right. But I'm just accepting when it comes to some of the songs. Here's what I found in the reading I was doing. To keep your armor bright, attend with constant care. Still walking in your captain's sight and watching unto prayer. That's the last four lines of that third stanza. To keep your armor bright, attend with constant care. Still walking in your captain's sight and watching unto prayer. I like that. And then when I found the whole song, I liked the next part even better. Pray without ceasing, pray, your captain gives the word, which is what he said. The captain is Jesus, and he just gave the word in sixth chapter. Paul writes it out there for us. It's inspired this way. Pray without ceasing, pray. Your captain gives the word. His summons cheerfully obey and call upon the Lord. To God your every want in instant prayer display. Pray always, pray and never faint. Pray without ceasing, pray. See, the beauty is that our Lord Jesus Christ has made possible the praying that is our part in the victory that's been gained. He uses our prayers. And I've said this to you a lot of times. I don't think our prayers are ever wasted. I think God receives them. In fact, if we are praying to the Father through the Son, by the time the Father gets them, the Son's got them in really good shape. What if he doesn't know who? I'll take care of it. It'll be me taking them to him. It'll be me that takes your prayers to the Father, Jesus said. How's it going to miss? He's going to take it and say, well, I need to take out a couple of things here and move this word over and take that comment. Look at that. That's exactly what your heart wants, isn't it? Yes, it is. Okay, let's send it to the Father. Praying. Paul says praying all the time with that armor on. And the armor indicates to us that what has been accomplished is going to be shared and given, and it is going to be ours as we live out this thing in the warfare, trusting in Him and Him alone. You sing this song sometime. I'm going to just give you the four lines. Put on the gospel armor, each piece put on with prayer. Where duty calls or danger, be never wanting there. You ever heard that song? Stand up for Jesus. Third stanza down in those last lines. And each of these songs have been inspired by Ephesians 6, verse 18. Praying. See, your captain's not gone away. He's with you. He said he would never leave us nor forsake us. His Holy Spirit is dwelling within us. There is the man in armor in Christ with Christ living in us by His Spirit, the Spirit dwelling in us. And when we begin to look at that, look, our attention is to what He has provided because our attention is on Him. Lord, here I am in full armor, not part of it. I didn't just bring a belt. Because truth is important, we sometimes think we can. Do you know you can have an orthodox church, that is, a church that believes basically the gospel truth that has absolutely no life and no power? Why? Because we don't pray. Because we don't bring the Holy Spirit into it. Because we're not trusting Him to do the work. We're just announcing the truth in language. There's a lot of folk who have a doctrine that's good, who haven't one time preached a gospel sermon believing that the power of the gospel would save a soul. You surprised? I told you about my friend of mine whose new pastor came. This is a Lutheran church. Martin Luther had a doctrine, didn't he? And the Lutheran church basically has that basic doctrine. They've been 19 years with the same pastor. He preached Jesus all the time, preached the gospel. People were saved. People were added to the church. All of that. They have a new man, 34 years old, just out of training. And he is preaching to them every week. And he said for weeks now he's preached, there is no mention of the gospel or the name of Jesus. We got an orthodoxy, but a pure target for the enemy. He'll lead you off into whatever is wrong in society and you'll buy it. Saying we got to have a good heart and love sinners. Yes, love sinners. That doesn't mean take sinners and put them in the kingdom. That doesn't work. That does not change a life. And a church ends up being social club, meeting place, way to kind of sit down and enjoy it, 30 minutes of whatever happens. God help us. Still here? Whole armor of God. Everything that we have to do has to be done in the spirit and the attitude of prayer. Now, there are two ways that I've heard in the Spirit described, and this is not the easiest place to make part of that work, but I'm going to tell you what I think it means in this setting. In the Spirit, pray all at all times in the Spirit with all prayer. It means that we pray in the context, in the presence, in the reality of His presence and working. Still here? Now, the one other place that we always got, and I heard people, this was preached to me a long time, and I've wrestled with it a long time, where you are, you know, praying in the Spirit is praying in tongues. Well, it could be, or it might not be. Because tongues is a gift of the Spirit, so you could pray in tongues in the Spirit. Or you could pray in tongues without Him. But the truth of the matter is, to pray in the Spirit cannot be just tongues. It wouldn't make sense in other places. It doesn't make sense in this one. It is in the realm of the Spirit that we pray. He said, you put on this whole armor. And the Spirit, of course, dwells within the believers. And when we start to speak, when we start to live in that whole armor, the Spirit helps us pray. I like what Paul had to say in the 8th chapter of Romans. He said, we don't know how to pray for some things. But the Spirit helps us with groanings that can't be spoken or uttered. Oh, and by the way, the uttering, groaning will not be the Spirit doing it. It'll be you doing it. Moved by the Spirit, yes. Worked in by the Spirit. And of course, I love some of the conversations we get into in dealing with the work of the Holy Spirit, because it just creates a lot of different stuff. It does. There are gifts of the Spirit. I do not believe that the gifts of the Holy Spirit can be classified as gone. But if they come around, there has to be a work of God that demands that again or that use somewhere, and He still does it. Why would God say, I won't do any more gifting? Because that's not the whole list. That's just a few that were involved in that first century church. What's He want us to do? He wants us to pray in the realm of the Spirit. He wants us to be open to the Holy Spirit. What would you do now if you had a doctor and you went to see the doctor and he came to see you and you know him a little bit, but you don't know him real well? And this doctor's been around a while. And he's giving instruction to his patient. And he said, let's pray. Now, I've seen this guy say, let's pray several times. And he grabs your hands as a family, and he starts to pray, and he's speaking some language from somewhere because he's praying in tongues. Ooh. Can he get fired? No, not this guy. He's already been doing it so long now, they're not going to fire him. It's who he is. And he doesn't try to make anything happen. Second or third time he'd done it like that? Ever. What I like best about him in the hospital is that he opens doors for me. If I can't get somewhere, he'll get me there. If he's around. He said, come on in here. Especially in an ER room or in a room up in the ICU, you're not supposed to necessarily be in right now. But he wanted us to pray. And we prayed. There are a lot of things that just happen. You don't have to make a doctrine out of it or try to explain it. You just need to find out what God wants you to do in praying in the Spirit, in the realm of the Spirit. We need Him. We need the working of His Spirit in His church. We need His revelation. We need His anointing. But be careful and stay with that which is tied to the armor and the Spirit, to Jesus, the Word. Don't make an individual experience a corporate one. If God does it, that's different. But he'll prepare us for anything like that. Mostly, he just wants our heart. So what I've discovered, what I think is true, is that in every single piece of the armor, we receive from him. And we identify with him. And we have to reach a point to where intimacy with the Lord, that is a relationship that is personal and real, is absolutely essential if praying is in the Spirit. If we're not dealing with God when we're praying, we miss the work of the Spirit in our hearts. So, orthodoxy is good, but not necessarily the end all of it. We need life. We need the Spirit of God working. Jesus prayed. You ever followed Jesus praying in the New Testament? Sometimes he prayed all night. You remember that? Sometimes he got up well before day and went to prayer, talked to the Father before he got his work started. And they'd go out. One time, I remember they went out and tried to find him because they needed him in another place. He was fellowshipping with the Father early in the day. Jesus prayed. It's not surprising that those who follow Jesus are taught to pray. Luke 18:1, that men ought always to pray and not to faint. You hear that line? Jesus talking about his men, his followers. So I think we can say if we don't continue to pray and maintain our relationship with the Lord that's personal and intimate, we're going to faint. Somewhere along the line, we're going to faint. You ever felt like you were close? Just, I can't do it anymore. Yep. I remember that. Time or two of that. When? Oh, I can't talk about when. That gets me too close to home. I talk about when. But I find that in that intimacy with him, strength comes, life comes, praying comes, and he is glorified. He is. One of the things that have made it possible for me to just be sustained in the work I do, calling I have, is every place I've ever pastored, and then beyond that, I had mostly little ladies and little retired men say, "Pastor, I'm praying for you every day, every day, every day, every day." And I knew they were. And so you kind of get down toward the faint mark, and you think, how can I even slow down? I got all these people praying for me. And the Lord showed me that he knew what was going on more than once. Just by activity, my favorite thing at all is one of the early people who prayed for me a lot. Grandma Bailey was her name. Some of you heard about Grandma Bailey. She lived in Decker Prairie. How many know where Decker Prairie is? Well, that's getting better, usually. Just remember this, Decker Prairie is over north, south of Magnolia, and Houston's a suburb to the south. So if you want to go to Houston, get out of Decker Prairie and go south. It works. Grandma Bailey lived in Decker Prairie, and so did I, in that area. I grew up there, and she'd been there my whole life from a child. Grandma Bailey was 88 years old at the time. I was 28. We had the same birthday. And we had this, she always said, "I'm praying for you, man. I'm praying for you." And she'd want me to come by the nursing home And when I could, I did, and I read scripture to her because she was losing her eyesight, couldn't read anymore. She loved the Word of God. So I went in one day, and she said, Brother Dan, I believe I've heard from the Lord. And He wants me to ask you, if you would come by tomorrow or the next day, I can't remember which, whether it was 2 days or one day, at about 2:00 in the afternoon. You're going to lay hands on me and pray for me, and I'm going to get my sight. Now, what am I going to do? You're going to pray, man. You're going to pray. And with trembling limbs and hands and head, I went to that huge Tomball hospital to see my prayer warrior and pray for her. I'm walking down through the entrance of the Tomball Hospital, only one, just a couple of wings out, and that was the hospital. And somebody meets me coming from the back, one of the family. It is exactly 2:00. He meets me and he says, Miss Bailey's gone. She just died. And I said, What is this, Lord? And then it didn't take long for the revelation to come. You talk about an easy funeral to preach. You talk about a theme to preach. It was absolutely perfect for her family. She knew what she had heard. She knew what He could do. And she had, because she'd prayed for me so long, she knew I'd do what she asked. Because I trusted her. Her theology was solid. She was a wonderful Christian all those years I knew her. And I said to her family, she got her prayer answered. It just got answered beyond her immediate expectation. She is very happy, blessed. She's home. I'll never forget that. No, it was not. My responsibility was to do what God wanted me to do. That is it. And that's all we do, isn't it? God uses every one of us in ways like that. And I do think, and I'm going to close, I think that we have to rethink some things about how to be disciples and make disciples in the culture we're in. How we're going to figure out to get to the place where we're really going to have an opportunity to speak to somebody, sit down and have coffee, finally, wherever we are, asking God in our praying to lay someone upon my heart today. Give me one soul that I can begin to walk with. What if we all did that? Now, some of us we're not evangelists. Now, I can preach evangelism and about how to be saved. I preached that for years and saw a lot of people say, but when I get one-on-one out there, it takes a work of God to get me to intercept some of those folk. Les won't have any trouble. He can do it. He's gifted that way. He is. Me, I had to have a lot of prayer. I'm the one that instituted all this knock-on-door stuff that we did at our churches early on. So we're going to go knock on doors, and they're going to love to see us. And I prayed, and I was scared spitless. I tried to encourage people to get ready to go, and I was scared spitless. But every time when I got started, took that first couple of steps and had the first door behind me, I was in the game. Until the next person told me to get away from their door and don't ever come back. Then that just kind of moves the spirit off somewhere. I don't know. It kind of hits you hard. But we'll do that. We'll think about it, talk about it, pray about it. Cultivate in your praying an awareness of His presence with you. A realization that He, the living Word, is with you. And the Word you're looking at, reading, receiving, is alive to you. And can make you an effective witness no matter where you are or what you're doing. Because it's not then about you anymore, it's about Him. And you're just the instrument. Amen. Let's pray. Father, I want to thank You for today. It's a good day, a day of worship, a day of sunshine, a day of beauty. And the greatest beauty of all is our living Father, our God, our Lord. Glorious reality of your love for us and the wonder of it all. We want to serve you. We want to walk with you. We want to put on the whole armor of God, fight the good fight of faith, and see your glorious name exalted. We surrender to you. Have your way with us. Make us what you want of us. Give us a hunger for souls to know Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.